Hello and welcome to this first look exploring session. Our final session, quite a short session this, looking at Act 5 of What You Will by John Marston. It's been, I don't know if it's a roller coaster ride, but it's definitely been a shift in tone over the last session and a bit. Where we've looked at the first four acts of the play. It seems to have definitely got a little bit darker, but maybe it always was dark. Maybe we just weren't catching the bitterness and the darkness of this satirical wit, or maybe it wasn't there. Who knows? Opinions may vary, and there's still room for opinions to change as we go into this final Act 5. Reading this Act 5 today, reading Pippo and Albano today, is...
Hi, Francis Cox, actor living in Amsterdam.
And reading Laverdure today is...
Hi, I'm Eric. I am here.
Everybody's got to be somewhere. Reading Randolfo today is...
Hi, Alan Scott, based in Suffolk.
Reading Lampatho and Andrea today is...
Hi, my name's Elizabeth Amisu and I'm an author based in Romford.
Reading Simplicius and Celia today is...
Hello, Dan, actor based in Montpellier, France.
Reading Quadratus today is...
Hello, I'm Lynn. I'm a college writing teacher. I live in the northwestern United States.
Reading Bidet, Francisco, and Lyzabetta is...
Rachael, Nicole, actor in New Jersey.
And reading Slip and Duke today is...
Briony, Sparrow, actor in Lincolnshire.
And just joining us, hopefully the internet is allowing this to function beautifully and the introduction will go perfectly. Reading Meletza and Jacomo is...
Helen Good, internet challenged from Hull.
Excellent. We are wonderfully corrected. It is lovely. And you may have seen the brief fluctuation of Sarah, who has now stepped down as potential Helen. But Helen, the original definite article, has appeared and will be performing Meletza and Jacomo. I'm your host, Robert Crighton. I will be reading stage directions and generally guiding us through this last discussion of this last act. Without further ado, we're going to dive into the text, unless I've missed anybody out. I don't think I have. From the last act, music has been playing as the interval has occurred between Act 4 and Act 5. We left in a slightly darker mood last time, and the curtains are drawn by a page, and Celia and Laverdure, Quadratus and Lyzabetta, Lampatho and Meletza, Simplicius and Lucia displayed sitting at dinner. The song is sung, during which a page whispers with Simplicius.
Feed and be fat, my fair Callipolis. Revo, here's good juice. Fresh borage, boy.
I commend myself to ye, lady.
In truth, sir, you dwell far from neighbours that are enforced to commend yourself.
Why, Simplicius, whither now, man? For good fashion's sake, stir not. Sit still, sit still.
I must needs rise. Much good do it you.
Dost thou think that thy rising will do them much good? Sit still, sit still. Carve me of that, good Meletza. Fill, Bacchus, fill.
I must needs be gone, and you'll come to my chamber tomorrow morning. I'll send you 100 crowns.
In the name of prosperity, what tide of happiness so suddenly flowed upon thee?
I'll keep a horse and 4 boys with grace of fortune now.
Now in faith get up and ride.
And I do not. I'll thwack a jerkin till he groan again with gold lace. Let me see. What should I desire of God? Marry, cloak lined with a rich taffeta, a white satin suit, and my gilt rapier from a pawn. Nay, she shall give me a chain of pearl that shall pay for all. Yeah, good boy, good senior, good boy, good senior.
Why now, thou speakest in the most embraced fashion that our time hugs. No sooner a good fortune or a fresh suit falls upon a fellow that would have been gull to have shoved you into society, but, and he meet you next, he fronts you with a faint eye, throws a quaint glance over a wide shoulder and cries, twixt the teeth, as a very parsimonious of breath, goodbye, good seniors, goodbye, good senior. Death, I will search the lifeblood of your hopes.
And a fresh pearl-colored silk stocking. Oh, I'll go to the half-crown ordinary every meal. I'll have my ivory box of tobacco. I'll converse with none but counts and courtiers. Now, good boy, good senior, a pair of massy silver spurs. To a hatched short sword and then your embroidered hanger and good senior.
Shut the windows, darken the room. The fellow fetch whips. The fellow is mad. He raves. Talks idly. Lunatic. Who procures thy
one that has eight fat capon? Suck the boiled chicken and let out his wit with the fool of bounty. One Fabius. I'll scorn him. He goes upon Fridays in black satin.
Fabius, by this light, a cogging cheater. He lives on love of merchants' wives. He stands on the base of maids. He furnishes your ordinary, for which he feeds scot-free, keeps fair gold in his purse to put on upon man's, by which he lives, and keeps a fair boy at his heels. He is damned, Fabius.
He is a fine man, law, and has a good wit, for when he lists, he can go in black satin, aye, and in a cloak lined with unshorn velvet.
By the salvation of humanity, he's more pestilent than the plague of lice that fell upon Egypt. Thou hast been a knave if thou credit it. Thou art an ass if thou follow it, and shalt be perpetual idiot if thou pursue it. Renounce the world, the flesh, the devil, and thy trust in men's wives. They will double with thee. And I so betake myself to the sucking of the juice capon, my ingle bottle ale, and his gentleman usher, that squires him, red herring. A fool I found thee, and a fool I leave thee. Bear record, heaven, 'tis against the providence of my speech. Goodbye. Good senior.
God boy. Yeah, good senior. What a fool tis. What an ass tis. Save you, young gentleman. Is she coming? Will she meet me? Shall's encounter her?
Yes, for here has entered Slip, Nos, Doit, and Bidet.
You were not lapped in your mother's smock. You ha not a good cheek. An enticing eye, a smooth skin, a well-shaped leg, a fair hand. You cannot bring a wench into a fool's paradise for you.
Well, not I by this garter. I am a fool, a very ninny. How call you her? How call you her?
Call her. You rise on your right side today, Mary. Call her. Her name is Mistress Perpetuana. She is not very fair, nor goes extraordinarily gay.
She has a good skin?
A good skin? She is wealthy. Her husband's a fool. She'll make you. She wears the breeches. She'll make you.
I'll keep two men, and they shall be tailors. They shall make suits continually, and those shall be cloth of silver.
You may go in beaten precious stones every day. Mary, I must acquaint you with some observances, which you must pursue most religiously. She has a fool, a natural fool waits on her, that is indeed her pander. To him, at the first, you must be bounteous. Whatsoe'er he craves, be it your hat, cloak, rapier, purse, or such trifle, gift. The knight will pay all. And to draw all suspect from pursuing her love for base gain's sake.
Gift? By this light, I'll gift, a word, gain. I care not for her chain of pearl, only for her love. game. The first thing her bounty shall fetch is my blush color satin suit from pawn. Gain.
When you hear one wind a cornet, she is coming down St. Mark's Street. Prepare your speech, suck your lips, lighten your spirits, fresh your blood, sleek your cheeks, for now thou shalt be made forever a perpetual and eternal gull.
And exit bidet.
I shall so ravish her with my courtship. I have such variety of discourse, such copy of phrase to begin as this. Sweet lady, you Ulysses' dog, after his master's 10 years travel, I shall so tickle her, or thus. Pure beauty, there is a stone.
Two stones, man.
Call, 'tis no matter what, I have the eloquence. I am not to seek, I warrant you.
And the cornet blows, enter Pippo Bidet. Pippo attired like a merchant's wife, and Bidet like a fool.
Sweet lady Ulysses' dog. There's a stone called, oh Lord, what shall I say?
Did all your eloquence come to this?
The glorious radiance of your glimmering eyes, your glittering beauties blind my wit and dazzled my...
I'll put my mask on, and please you, pray you, wink, pray you.
Oh, fine man. My mistress loves you best. I dreamt you got me this sword and dagger. I love your hat and feather. Oh!
Oh no. Do not cry, man. Do not cry. Man, thou shalt have them. Aye, and they were...
Oh, they were... purse with all the white pence in it. Fine man, I love you. Give me the fine red pence soon at night. I thank you. Where's the fool now?
He has all of my money. I have to keep myself. And he...
Pot!
Sir, the fool shall lead you to my house. The fool shall not. At night I expect you. Till then, take this seal of my affection.
What? Simplicius!
I come, Quadratus. Gentlemen, as yet I can but thank you, but I must be trusted for my ordinary soon at night, or stay, the fool hath unfurnished me, but 'twill come again, good boy.
What ho, Simplicius!
Good boy, good boys. I come, good boys, good boys.
And exit Simplicius. I'm just going to pause there as well, just to give us a chance to sort of catch up with what's going on. What's going on? Alan.
Another inserted comedy scene that's got damn all to do with the plot, from my feeling.
There you go.
I've not got a feeling any of this has been signposted particularly heavily earlier. There was a bit of foreshadowing, but not a lot.
Yeah. The pages in their scene, they mentioned that this would be a fun trick to play, but not, it wasn't very well developed. Right?
Yeah. Rachel.
I think, I mean, this doesn't, I think, have anything to do with the main plot, but there was a thing that I saw somewhere once, and it was like, you know, there were certain people back in the day who you would go to their houses, and that's where you would meet with your Mr. or your mistress, and they would have like these types of houses. So I feel like this is a nighttime arrangement of like Scooby-Doo doors of everybody going in between these different rooms to have their affairs.
Dan, what was your feeling about what you would do? What's going on in Simplicius's mind?
Just walking in here, it feels like that he just wants to woo someone and is a pretty innocent fellow and doesn't really get everything that's going on. Yes. That's what I got. Just like me, I don't really know what's going on.
No, I mean, this is the thing. Who is he trying to woo? I don't know who he's wooing.
Sweet
Does he know who he's wooing?
Dog. Yeah.
Eric.
I was going to say that it's basically mirroring the previous bit of the scene where Quadratus is talking to, what's his name? Not Bidet.
Simplicius?
No, at the beginning of the scene. Yeah, he kind of, but I don't know if he's just like lecturing people or like talking to Simplicius about this is how you woo a woman kind of thing. I don't know. It just kind of feels very, the whole unsolicited advice thing is like, why are they throwing all this advice at Simplicius? Or is it sort of, because he's the new one, isn't he? He's the new servant as well. We were told in that ridiculous scene with the Emperor Hardenrificacuminus or something, that he was one of the new ones. And he had been inducted into the sort of fraternity of servants and pages.
Yeah.
So maybe this is like the stunt that they're pulling to sort of, I don't know, get him to participate or something.
Hmm.
Rites of initiation, I mean.
Rachel?
No, I also just wanted to say about the, like, sensuality of the language. Like, Marston's, you know, brings up the clothes again, you know, but the texture of velvet and the texture of pearls, you know, I mean, that's a gem that, what do you call it? You know, you can tell a fake one from a real one in the same way that, like, you know, you take gold and you have to put it in your mouth to know if it's real or not, because if it's fake, it's smooth, and if it's real, you know, it's rough, like sand. I don't. There's also the, like, talking about the food and all these different things that just have taste or touch or some sort of smell to invoke something in the actor.
Any other thoughts? Anyone got a particular handle on what's going on with Simplicius here? It's fine for us not to know. It's a good thing if we don't know, to a degree. Obviously, at some point, we do need to know. Helen?
Yes, it's a little bit more of the Lily style, a bunch of kids fooling an adult.
Mm.
So, you know, the younger children, very successfully here, fooling an adult. I mean, when you said to ask Dan what's going on in Simplicius's mind, I thought, not very much.
But he gets up with intent. He gets up and he believes that he's in on a good thing. He's going to be... so he obviously has someone at some point... So, because we were talking yesterday about what was going on with Meletza, and you know, I'm just wondering if there's been a sort of little nudge, wink, wink occurred, and in his mind he thinks he's on a winner there, or something like that.
He wants to be the lover, the paid lover, the well remunerated lover of a rich merchant's wife.
Mm.
This appears to be his aim in life.
So is it just simply because he's been invited to the table that he thinks he can? That's inevitably what's going to happen here. It's just I'm finding this action without reason is clearly given yet. Dan, then Eric.
Just something about the text that gives a cue in, and this is something just we were looking at in the script here. That was modified, this whole good boy, good senior thing, seems to me just like an expression rather than goodbye as a farewell. It seems more of a derivative of the whole God's boy or good boy, you know, that kind of thing. And so he keeps proclaiming it over and over because he's just so in awe of his situation, it seems to me, in the context, as opposed to he's just weirdly saying goodbye all the time.
Hmm.
Yeah.
I'll go to Lynn then Eric.
I'm not actually following you, Dan, because in my text it says goodbye.
Right.
So I don't know if that's an emendation.
It has been.
Or what?
In the original print, in the 1607 printing, it's good boy.
Okay.
It's just been modified.
There's a number of places where we're saying good boy, and my text says goodbye. So I don't know if your text says something different or what's going on there.
Yeah, when I refer back to it, and then it says God boy at other times, which is why I'm saying that. This seems to be just yet another derivative of the whole God's blood, God's whatever, you know, Zunes, all that. It's because it didn't make sense to me when I was reading it over that he would just be saying goodbye as a farewell all the time. But it makes much more sense as an expression of some sort of awe or amazement there. Not necessarily a swear, but can be read as a swear and would be therefore taken out, possibly.
Eric.
I was going to say that, because at some point they're talking about shut the windows, darken the room, fetch whips, so the fellow is mad, he raves, and so on. And but like both he and both Quadratus and Simplicius are talking in third person at some point. But I was wondering who they're talking about. And it just feels like maybe they're talking about Lampatho, who's being a bit of an sort of over the top sort of, what's it called? Lover boy, basically. Like in the previous bit, we saw if these scenes are meant to run together as well. He's been courting Meletza with no response. And also they mentioned Fabius and various mentions and stuff. And and then it feels like when Simplicius and meets Bidet as the fool of the gentleman coming in and the gentlewoman, it feels like he's in on it. Because he actually says good gentleman, goodbye, and that kind of thing. So he doesn't salute anyone as, you know, good lady. He doesn't seem to believe that Pippo is a lady.
Well, the thing, good senior, it's an expression, especially when he's saying God boy, this is why I think it's relevant to bring that up, because he's referring to God again, you know, good Lord, essentially.
Yeah.
That's my reading of it, at least.
Yeah. Anyway, we may be getting too bogged down on that, but the question has been raised, in which there may be more data because the sequence is still going on. I paused at a slightly artificial point. But we've just had the exit of Simplicius, and Bidet and Pippo are remaining to discuss, presumably, what they've just been doing.
Fool shall wait on thee. Now do I merit to be yclept, Bosphorus, Carmelidon, Honorific Cacumino Spide, who has any square dice?
Marry, sir, that have I.
Who has any square dice?
Marry, sir, that have I.
Thou shalt lose thy share for it in our purchase.
I pray you now.
Sooner the whistle of a mariner shall sleek the rough curbs of the ocean back. Now speak, I like myself. Thou shalt lose thy share.
Enter Quadratus, Laverdure, and Celia, Simplicius, Meletza, Lyzabetta, I don't recall them exiting, Lucia, and Lampatho.
Ha! Take all then, ha!
Without cloak, or hat, or rapier, fie!
Ah, oh, it's me. Look yonder. Who gave you these things?
Mistress Perpetuana's fool.
Mistress Perpetuana's fool? There lies a jest. Senior, the fool promised me he would not leave me.
I know the fool well. He will stick to you. Do not use to forsake any youth that is enamored on another man's wife. He strives to keep company with a crimson satin suit continually. He loves to be all one with a critic, a good wit, self-conceited, a hawk bearer, a dog keeper, and great with the nobility. He dotes upon a mere scholar, an honest, flat fool, but above all, he is all one with a fellow whose cloak hath a better inside than his outside, and his body richer lined than his brain.
Gods. So I am cousin.
Pray you, master, pardon me. I must lose my share.
Give me my purse again.
You gave it me, and I'll keep.
Well done, my honest crack. Thou shalt be my ingle for it.
You shall keep all, maugre thy beardless chin, thy eyes.
I may go starve till midsummer quarter.
Oh, fool! Get thee hence.
I'll to school again, that I will. I left in Ass in Presenti, and I'll begin in Ass in Presenti. And so, good night, fair gentry.
Exit Pippo.
The triple idiot's coxcomb crown thee, bitter epigrams confound thee, cuckold be whene'er I'll bride thee, though every comic scene be drawn, never come thy clothes from pawn, never may thy shame be sheathed, never kiss a wench sweet breast.
And before the cornet sound, I just thought I'd just briefly pause there to see if that has helped the situation or whether there are additional confusions. Any thoughts in the room about the conclusion of that thread? Because I think it's concluded now. There may be a bit more to it later, but I suspect.
Yeah, evidently. Simplicius has figured out that his supposed girlfriend was actually Pippo in a woman's clothes, and they're not going to give him his stuff back. But it doesn't really say how that recognition happened. Don't know.
Yeah, Rachel.
I mean, Simplicius is a fool, right? They've kind of made a fool of a fool. I don't know, a jest of the fool made, I don't know.
He's not a fool in the sense of a professional fool or anything like that. He's just a simpleton. He's a courtier he's a friend of Quadratus and Lampatho, but he's just like he's the stoogiest of the stooges. He's just not very bright.
Yes, we got someone who previously was dressed pretending to be a fool. So Bidet was pretending to be a fool. But in a way of cozening him. So Simplicius has been gulled out of some coin, so give me my purse again. And is going, no, you gave it to me, so I'm going to keep it. Solid logic there from Bidet. So that's how it worked. All perfectly clear, I'm sure. I feel this is one that needs workshopping. Eric.
It's very much that thing of like big fish eats small fish, eats even smaller fish kind of thing, where, you know, the Quadratus has been taking out his problems on Bidet, and Bidet has been taking out his problems on Simplicius. I mean, not explicitly, but you get that sense that like Simplicius is at the bottom of the food chain.
I don't know. I think Pippo technically should be at the bottom of the food chain because he's one of the young lads. So it may be big fish nipping at small fish who nips at medium-sized fish sort of chain there.
Also, Holofernes is one of the smallest ones, but he gets away with it because he's got the great voice.
Yeah, Holofernes, Pippo, was attired like a merchant's wife and now leaves in as imprecentis, so he's fine. So that's a return joke from earlier. It was hilarious the first time round. I'm sure it's even more so this time. Okay, let's go into the conclusion, shall we say, the A plot, in the sense that there is a plot, and see how the play concludes. So. Enter as many pages with torches as you can. Check your budgets first before attempting this scene. Randolfo, Andrea, Jacomo, bareheaded, and the Duke with attendants.
Cease! The Duke approacheth. It is almost night. The Duke's up. Now begins his day. Come, grace his entrance. Lights! Lights! Now begins our play.
Still these same bawling pipes sound softer strains. Slumber our sense, tut, these are vulgar strains. Cannot your trembling wires throw a chain of powerful rapture about our mazed sense? Why is our chair thus cushioned tapestry? Why is our bed tired with wanton sports? Why are we clothed in glistering attires if common bloods can hear, can feel, can sit as soft, lie as lascivious, strut all as rich as the greatest potentate? Soul, and you cannot feast my thristing ears with aught but what the lip of common birth can taste. Take all away, your labours idly waste. What sport for night?
a comedy entitled Temperance.
What sot elects that subject for the court? What should Dame Temperance do here? Away, the itch on Temperance, your moral play.
Duke, prince, royal blood, thou that hast the best means to be damned of any lord in Venice, thou great man, let me kiss thy flesh. I am fat and therefore faithful. I will do that which few of thy subjects do, love thee. But I will never do that which all thy subjects do, flatter thee. Thy humor's real. Good, a comedy. No, and thy sense would banquet in delights, appropriate to the blood of emperors, peculiar to the state of majesty, that none can relish but dilated greatness. Vouchsafe to view the structure of a scene that stands on tragic solid passion. Oh, that's fit to traffic, to commerce with births, strained from the mud of base unable brains. Give them a scene, may force their struggling blood, rise on tiptoe and attention, and fill their intellect with pure, elixir wit. Oh, that's for greatness apt, for princes fit.
Darest thou then undertake to suit our ears with such rich vestment?
Sorry, I've lost... Oh, my computer just jumped to... Oh, sorry.
So dare.
Yes, my prince, I dare. Nay, more, I will. And I'll present a subject with worth thy soul. The honored end of Cato Uticant.
Who'll personate him?
Marry, that will I, on sudden, without change.
Thou want'st a beard.
Tush, a beard ne'er made Cato, though many men's Cato hang only on their chin. Suppose this floor, the city of Utica, that the time, the night that prolonged Cato's death. Now, being placed among his philosophers, These first discourse of the soul's eternity.
Cato grants that, I am sure, for he was valiant and honest, which an epicure ne'er was, and a coward never will be.
Then Cato holds a distinct notion of individual actions after death. This being argued, his resolve maintains a true magnanimous spirit should give up dirt to dirt, and with his own flesh, dead his flesh. For chance should force it couch unto his foe. To kill oneself, some hold it, no. Oh, these are points would entice away one's soul to break indenture of base percentage.
Somewhere around here enters Francisco, probably not for another couple of lines.
And run away from his body in swift thought, to melt in contemplation, contemplation's luscious sweets. Now, oh my voluptuous Duke, I'll feed thee sense worth his creation. Give me audience.
My liege, my royal liege, hear my suit.
Now may thy breath ne'er smell sweet as long as thy lungs can pant for breaking my speech, thou Muscovite, thou stinking perfumer.
And enter Albano.
Is not this Albano, our sometimes courtier?
No, troth, but Francisco, you're always perfumer.
Lorenzo Celso, our brave Venice Duke, Albano Beletzo, thy merchant, thy soldier, thy courtier, thy slave, thy anything, thy what thou wilt, kisseth thy noble blood. Do me right, or else I am canonized a cuckold. Canonized a cuckold. I am abused. My wife abused. My clothes abused. My shape, my house, my all abused. I am sworn out of myself, beated out of myself, baffled, jeered at, laughed at, barred my own house, debarred my own wife. Whilst others swill my wines, gormandize my meat, kiss my wife. Oh gods, oh gods, oh gods, oh gods.
Who is it?
sweet. This is your wagger, your faith, as if you knew him not.
Yes, I fear I do too well. Would I could slide away invisible.
Assured, this is he.
My worthy liege, the jest comes only thus. Now to stop and cross it with mere like deceit, or being known, the French knight hath disguised a fiddler like Albano too, to fright the perfumer. This is all.
Art sure it is true?
Tis confessed, tis right.
Aye, tis right, tis true, right. I am a fiddler, a fiddler, a fiddler. Uds, fart, a fiddler. I'll not believe thee. Thou art a woman, and tis known, veritas non quaerit angulus. Truth seeks not to lurk under varthingals. Veritas non quaerit angulus. A fiddler?
Worthy sir, pardon, and permit me first to confess to yourself, your deputation dead, hath made my love live to offend you.
Aye, mock on, scoff on, flout on, do, do, do.
Truth, sir, in serious.
Aye, good, good. Come hither, Celia. Burst breast, rive heart asunder, Celia. Why startest thou back? Seest thou this, Celia? Oh me, how often with lascivious touch thy lip hath kissed this mark? How oft this much wronged breast hath borne the gentle weight of thy soft cheek?
Oh me, my dearest lord, my sweet, sweet love.
What a fiddler, a fiddler? Now thy love? I am sure thou scorn'st it. Nay, Celia, I could tell what on the night before I went to sea and took my leave with hymeneal rite, what thou list into my ear, a fiddler and a perfumer now?
And?
Dear brother?
Most respected signor, believe it by the sacred end of love, that much, much wrong hath forced your patience, proceeded from most dear, a fired love, devoted to your house.
Believe it, brother.
Nay, yourself, when you shall hear the occurrences, will say 'tis happy, comical.
Assure thee, brother.
Shall I be brave? Shall I be myself now? Love, give me thy love. Brothers, give me your breasts. French knight, reach me thy hand. Perfumer, thy fist. Duke, I invite thee. Love, I forgive thee. Frenchman, I hug thee. I know all. I'll pardon all, and I'll laugh at all.
Albano and his brothers talk apart.
And I'll curse you all. Oh, yeah, interrupt a scene.
Quadratus, we will hear these points discussed with apter and more calm affected hours.
Well, good, good.
Was it even so, i'faith? Why then, capricious mirth? Skip light, Morris goes in our frolic blood. Flagged veins, sweat plump with fresh infused joys. Laughter pucker our cheeks, make shoulders shog with chucking lightness. Love, once more thy lips, forever clasp our hands, our hearts, our crests. Thus front, thus eyes, thus cheek, thus all shall meet, shall clip, shall hug, shall kiss, my dear, my sweet. Duke, wilt thou see me revel? Come, love, dance, court, gallants, court, suck amorous dalliance.
Beauty, your heart.
Thus, sir, accept my hands. She leaps too rash that falls in sudden bands.
Shall I despair? Never will I love more.
No sea so boundless vast, but hath a shore.
Why, marry me, thou canst have but soft flesh, good blood, sound bones, and that which fills up all your bracts, good stones.
Stones, trees, and beasts, in love still firmer prove than man. All none, no hold fasts in your loves.
Since not the mistress. Come on, faith, the maid.
10,000 ducats too, to boot, are laid.
Why then, wind, wind, cornets, lead on, jolly lad.
Excuse me, gallants, though my legs lead wrong, 'tis my first footing without my full tongue.
Tis well, tis well. How shall we spend this night?
Gulp reddish wine, my liege. Let our paunch rent. Suck merry jellies. Preview, but not prevent. No mortal can the miseries of life.
I home invite you all. Come, sweet, sweet wife, my liege, vouchsafe thy presence. Drink till the ground look blue, boy.
Live still in springing hopes, still in fresh new joys. May your love's happy hit in fair-cheeked wives, your flesh still plump with sapped restoratives. That's all my honest frolic heart can wish. A fico for the mew of an envious pish. Till night, I wish good food and pleasing day, but then sound rest. So ends our slight writ play.
And so ends our slight writ play. I think that's not an unreasonable description. It does feel very sketched out. It's like we had the last act, they were saying, there's going to be a play. And then this act, there's going to be a play. And it's basically just a setup gag of, let me tell you what the play is going to be. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. And then the plot comes in and goes, but I want to do my play. and it's just immediately discarded. A comedy called Temperance. There are many potential plays called Temperance over the years. We have some fragments of one from a good 60-odd years earlier, available now on the podcast. It's the kind of moral play that this Duke has no interest in. I like the way the Duke sort of opens by just going, what's the point in having all these lovely things if the lower sort have effectively access to nice things too? I mean, it just takes the edge off being rich and privileged if everybody can have it as well. I mean, isn't this awful? It's an odd court of the Duke. And, there's, all these hints at action that seems to be inferred at, but we don't actually get precise descriptions of. So, wherever the Albano's mark is on his body is not described, when, you know, to demonstrate the secret birthmark to demonstrate who he is. There's no particularly helpful clear cue on how that works or where it is, or what he whispers in her ear. The sweet nothings that this callback to the hymeneal rites that he talked about. They it was obviously one hell of a session. That time, good things were said. Thoughts from the room. I've been wittering on, sort of trying to give everyone a chance to get their mind together about this. Eric.
The ending feels a bit like the ending of Common Conditions, where it just went, well, we don't have any more time. This is where the play stops. Sorry, bye.
Yeah, it does feel like the writer hit a deadline, didn't it? And it just went, okay, yeah, we Act 5, we'll wrap it all up. Stuff. Francis.
Yeah, Albano's forgiveness of everybody was pretty sudden.
Yeah.
I mean... Yeah, at one point he's raging, and then he's like, oh, yeah, it's fine. I'm laughing now.
Shall I be brave? Shall I be myself again now? Yeah. And that's his journey from that to that. Quadratus is less forgiving. And then there seems to be the suggestion of various people who are maybe trying to pair off, but not quite sure what's going on with the potential pairings off that are potentially going on there. And if you hurry, you will catch that train. Other thoughts. it's a great sound. It's a good sounding train. It's got a good horn on it. Eric.
I was just wondering, Albano at some point goes 10,000 ducats to boot our lady, and I have no idea what that refers to.
No, indeed. There's lots of things that Albano says that, I mean, he really goes for it, doesn't he? He's abused, apparently. All of these things are abused. Every element is abused. His shape, his house, his all. He's had a bad time, and he's going to call on the gods many, many times. He's not a happy bunny.
No.
That makes the turnaround even harder to sort of countenance. Yeah. Elizabeth.
Yeah, I was wondering about the significance of the cornets, because we've had alarum sounds before, but this is, I think, a different medium. It has a different kind of effect. Also, I got a little bit lost in the last act, because I think that the text doesn't quite flow because of all these like little little interludes that kind of go on throughout the play. It kind of, you lose focus on the main plot that should run through it.
Mm. Yeah, and I think specificity about cornets is that they're a more an interior instrument, so that they're not quite as blowing your head off as your pucker big trumpet that you'll have out for outdoor shows. I think that's the logic of cornets specifically. But yeah, it's like the Duke is introduced incredibly late as, hello, I'm the Deus Ex Machina, just in case, I'm just here to make sure everything's sorted out. Lynn.
But isn't this the play where in the beginning he basically lights his cigar on the brother's, you know, suit, he bookends that, and he's pretty useless both times. Mm. He just lives for pleasure.
He not only lives for pleasure, he's really keen on pulling up the ladder on anyone else having a bit of fun as well. I mean, it's just, you know, yeah. Other thoughts, Helen?
Yes, I thought it was rather nice idea. Ah, the sun's gone down, the Duke's day begins.
Yeah, nice imagery. Yeah,
yeah. It's I've known people like that, but it doesn't work in the long term. Mm.
The Duke's response as well. You know, what sot elects that subject for the court? Temperance for this court? Have you never been to a harvester before?
It's like you don't even know me.
Yeah. Are you trying to make a point? Sorry, I cut you off, Helen.
Yeah, I think actually that with the right cast and a certain amount of merriment, this could actually be quite a fun play. Mm. It is deplorably short on plot, but there is one. I mean, man goes away, everyone assumes he's dead, argument over who the widow shall marry, man reappears in the middle of other people's confusion, crosstalk, lack of recognition, all sorted out in the end. It's a plot. Mm. And then you can add on to that fun with pages and fun with courtiers and fun with arguments and all sorts of stuff, which isn't terribly relevant, but it would make a pleasant evening's entertainment, provided you weren't looking for, I don't know, Ibsen.
Yeah, I think that's a good point that, you know, the material is here. I mean, there's a lot of work to be done, but this kind of entertainment, which is, you know, a bit of a souffle at times, it's got a darker edge to it, and there's various problematic elements of the text that we'd need to look at today. But it's the kind of thing where actually you need a really tight company to make it work regardless. It would need a tight company to make it work then, let alone to make it work now with all the additional challenges that time and a more equitable society layers on. Eric, then Rachel.
I was going to say that I think I know what happened. I think they were playing the drinking game, you know, the what you will, how many times can you mention it, and then they just got drunker and drunker and they had to resolve the plot somehow.
Yes, there is this constant thing, how many times can you get the plot title in? last act, I think it was. It kept popping up every 5 minutes. It was there a lot. Rachael, then Lynn.
I wonder if this is... I feel like Marston has some criticism for the wealthier class, or like the nobility, that he puts a lot in his plays, because, I mean... the Duke doesn't resolve anything, and he has a governmental position. And these rich people really don't seem to care a lot about anything. I mean, Albano does, and that until she says, "Oh, I'm so sorry," and then it's all back to normal. And he's like, "Come over to my house, my wife's ex-boyfriend."
Right. Lynn, then Elizabeth.
I'm on. Is this thing on? Yeah, I was just, when Rob said that this requires a tight company, I was reminded of how many times people interrupt one another in this play, which, you have to have rehearsal time in order to make that work. You have to have people that are used to working together. So, yeah, it would definitely require some work, because keeping it going and keeping it sort of aloft, it's kind of a juggling trick. You got to keep those balls in the air, or you're just going to embarrass yourself. It would be, I think it could be a good evening's entertainment, as Helen says, but it would definitely require some choreographing and a lot of practice.
Yeah, we've noticed that there's sort of kind of crosstalk and cutting in over people's lines. Does keep cropping up in boy companies plays or things where that sort of expectation is there. That I mean, that isn't to say it doesn't appear in playhouse other playhouse dramas, but it's much more prevalent in when you have children. Elizabeth.
Yeah, I was thinking about the text when it says, I think, Perpetuana's fall. It keeps making this distinction that it's a natural fall. And I didn't know what that meant.
Anyone want to leap in on that one?
Learning
Helen?
Disabled in modern terms. Mm.
Yes, there's a natural fool is someone who is born without much in the way of mental capacity. So they are a fool by nature. Nature has made them a fool.
Opposed to someone just pretending. Mm.
As opposed to the Lord of Misrule type fool who, you know... someone who plays the fool.
Yeah, who's probably smarter than the average bear.
Right. Yes.
To keep the routine going.
Right. So the best example would probably be, the most well-known example is Will Kemp, who would play the role of the natural fool in before he went off and did his jig. And then later on, you had the smarter fools, such as Robert Armin, who would play the ones who were... the King's Confidant, for example, who was always really witty and with the remarks and with the rejoinders. So as opposed to just a dumb servant, which is the natural fool.
Eric.
I was going to say, like, pertaining to this question, we kind of saw the two types in Mother Bombay, I think, because we got two natural fools trying to marry each other, but then we also had the artificial foolery generally.
Okay, we're into final thoughts for this session, but also the play overall. Briony, any final thoughts?
I found the plot a little bit thin for me. I appreciate what Helen said, but it didn't really... He forgot who he was, and then he remembered who he was, and no big thing had happened in that time. It was, but some of the words were really, really amazing in this.
Francis, any final thoughts?
I've been baffled by this play, I have to say. I think I've been more baffled by this one than any of the plays I've read with Beyond Shakespeare. But I agree with Helen. There's a good night's entertainment buried in this script. And I also agree with Lynn, you know, you're really good company to make this work. I think it's one of those plays that it's better to watch it than to actually read it.
I think there's an awful lot of detail about where people are and who they're talking to and stuff that the script isn't quite giving us enough data on.
Yeah.
That makes a huge amount of difference. Rachael, final thoughts?
Yeah, the plot, I think it's very funny. There were a lot of parts of this where I genuinely laughed. I think Marston writes really, you know, horrible characters really well, characters that you love to hate really well. The plot in the end, I couldn't make heads or tails of it, but I just thought it was funny overall. So yeah, I do think it's a good night, but I don't think it's like Helen said, don't look for, you know, something deeper in this.
Yeah, well, you know, we're here to analyze what it is, not to wish it was something else. Eric, any final thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's one of these plays that you have to go at like full tilt so that you don't really get what the holes in the plot, if there are any. I mean, if there is either plot or holes. Yeah, it's. I just like the sort of contrast between like sort of Lampatho going, "Shall I despair? Never will I love more." And then you get Meletza's answer, and then Quadratus is going, "Why marry me?" You know, sort of offering himself up to anyone who'll take him. and yeah, I was thinking maybe this ending is sort of like a sort of, I don't know, a proto like Singing in the Rain type thing where it doesn't really make sense, but it's fun.
Yeah, where they've constantly done this meta thing of going, well, now we're at the end of the act. Can we have the music accompaniment go, please? So maybe there's an almost an element of just going, Albano, could you just make everyone happy at the end, please, by being okay? Why? Because the play needs to end. Okay, right. and change mood. Elizabeth, any final thoughts?
Yeah, I agree with Francis and with Rachael. I found the text a little bit baffling. I think it's partly because I missed Thursday session, but also because of the very nature of the text. But one thing that kind of jumped out at me that was really good about it was the character of Quadratus. I loved his speeches and I loved his character. And I think that... we shouldn't take away from the text that there are some really well-drawn characters in it.
Yes, no, I think the character drawing is superb. Yeah. And Marston has consistently been very good at even minor characters leap out at you and give you as an actor something to do. Alan, any final thoughts?
I must admit, I see it as a two-act play, which has then had three acts worth of pre-existing sketch material from somewhere else, which were proven winners in another environment, shoehorned into it. It didn't hang together as a piece for me at all. And it almost reminded me of the way that the Spike Milligan Q series used to end, with everybody running around going, "What do we do now? What do we do now? What do we do now?"
Lynn, any final thoughts?
Yeah, I think Alan's right. It is a little stitched together, and I think maybe the way to do it is to lean into that rather than try to make it look seamless with your staging. If you had a nice big stage, you could use the areas of the stage to indicate when you've got basically parenthetical material. This is a little aside. This is a little digression. Don't worry, it'll be fun. Because as Elizabeth says, some of the characters are really interesting. I would actually kind of like to pick out Lampatho and Quadratus and like see what their arc looks like. They have, I think, or could have, a really interesting rivalry / friendship, and they both seem to sort of shift their character. So like working with those two might just really be interesting and fruitful, and a growth experience for an actor. It's it's troubled. And what we haven't also mentioned that I think we should is the, I'm pretty uncomfortable with the ableism of the stutter. Not a fan. But there are so many local moments that are so smart. There are just local moments where it's just like, man, Marston is smart. And I did enjoy that.
Mm. Dan, you've only been here for this act. You haven't got a clue what's going on. any final thoughts?
You are correct in that assessment there. I certainly am not in any kind of position to give to pass any kind of judgment on the quality of this play. I can say that from what I've seen, there are some well-drawn out characters, as has been observed. Observations about whether it plays better when you see it, obviously that remains to be seen. I can see that this is a satirical comedy. I can see definitely Marston's intelligence in his writing there. Whether it actually holds together as a full piece is another story. I'll speak to this is the only thing I can see, is to the quality of the printing of this text, especially as compared to another play that we had just seen from Marston a week ago, printed by Valentine Sims. That was a text that had stage directions abound inserted in places where Marston himself was saying, well, I apologize for not being there for the printer, but you can see it was a pretty well-illustrated text. It really laid out how you wanted to stage this play. You have a different printer here, George Eld, who doesn't do nearly the same type of job with it. And it makes it very difficult for us reading this to figure out the missing pieces of it. Whereas the other one, you can see, well, it's much easier to follow. You can imagine it much more clearly because things are illustrated on the page more clearly in the printing. So, you know, it's unfair to compare printers there, but I think it really does affect the text. All the traces of Marston are here with the really long dashes, the interruptions and whatnot. Marston is very precise in the way that he writes. And you can see that this derived from some sort of manuscript from him. But unfortunately, we've been left with this printing that leaves a lot to us to interpret there. So a lot of workshopping would do this really well. Because Marston does tend to really try to spell out how he wants things done, especially with these detailed stage directions, even with the spellings of things as well. I don't know how much the printer or the compositors maintained it, but I'm sure a study can show that Marston favors this type of spelling over other ones, and that's been done on a lot of his other printings where we knew he was involved in the printing, or at least interested in the printing.
Helen?
I think you've had my thoughts. I am continually going back to a comparison with Lily, because you've got two completely separate sets of people who are, in fact, I think you may even have three completely separate sets of people, and it's jolly good luck to you if they manage to meet at the end of Act Five. Mm. And in fact, they don't. Mm. In the what I think of as the pages plot doesn't intersect.
Mm. Yes, the specter of Lily has popped up more than once this week, so I may do again. We shall see. All that remains, however, is to thank all these wonderful readers for all their wonderful reading. Thank you very much, everyone, and goodbye. Thou wantst a beard.